Thank you very much. Thank you, Yav. Thank you for, you're so close to Wales. I should probably say Diolch yn Fawr. I'm sure probably Bristol was Welsh once, given it has a Welsh name. Anyway, thank you very much for having me back a third time. We were just talking before the session about whether I miss it or quite like the Zoom thing. I do miss the going to other places, but certainly the 5.5 hour trip from Bangor to Bristol by train is, you know, getting anywhere in South Wales or near South Wales is horrendous. So that bit I don't miss, but you know, it would be nice to visit in person. Should a time, and if you want me back a fourth time. Yeah, so let me just do the plugs first. So dothink.org, do have a look. There's stuff on Stanley Kubrick I can refer you to based on, if you want a quick, easy, soundbitey something to read. But yes, and you're welcome to contribute. So the idea is to provide an open voice for anybody really to publish something they don't think they could publish in an existing Jewish publication. So check us out, have a read. Yoav is our biggest reader, I think. Our reader. Yes, I do enjoy his feedback and not always positive, but that's fine. Okay, so yeah, I'll get the inevitable. This is my what I've done. So if you want to know, it used to be 20 years ago, who's this young man telling us about someone we remember? All right, I'm no longer young. Here are my credentials, but all available for purchase. And it's basically this book I'm going to summarize for you. So this came out in 2018 and is now available in paperback. I published this one in 2019 about Kubrick's final film, Eyes Wide Shut. And this one's a bit more for the students. Just came out a couple of weeks ago. Is an edited volume on state of art research on Stanley Kubrick. So those are my credentials. In case anyone, I just remember I did a PhD on the early Cold War, and people would say, "Well, what do you know about that, Sonny?" Because I lived through it and you didn't. So you sort of can't really answer that one. But there you go. All right. I can't see anyone anymore. So can I just get a verbal yes that you're seeing this okay?
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
Excellent. Okay. Right. So Stanley Kubrick, New York Jewish intellectual. I'll just give you a bit of background. I'd always sort of been a fan of his. I was only fortunate enough to see, or unfortunate enough to see, two of his movies in the cinema. Full Metal Jacket in 1987. So I was just old enough to get into that. So I was about 15. And that presumably was a 15. And then Eyes Wide Shut in 1999, which I remember came out on Erev Rosh Hashanah. So I went to see it in the Finchley Lido and then went home for dinner, for Yontif dinner. So those are the only two films I saw. But it always sort of remained in the background. And then I got my job at Bangor. And I was asked, what would I like to teach? And I thought, well, no one teaches directors in film studies. They do in English literature, but they tend to teach genres or themes in film studies, rarely directors. Maybe Hitchcock in the past, Woody Allen, obviously he's fallen a bit out of favor recently. But the one that that I thought I would go for was Stanley Kubrick. And there was a couple of reasons. At that point, there were only 13 extant movies and a couple of them were short. So you could fit all of his films into one semester. Secondly, it covered nearly every genre. So you could cover every genre anyway. And the one he never made is the genre I like least, which is the Western. So I was teaching him from 2007 and it took me about 4 years of teaching him, 4 to 5 years, thinking, what could I say that's new about Stanley Kubrick? Just for context, he's probably, if not, he's one of, if not the most written about directors ever. I mean, he's probably up there with Hitchcock. But the volume of work just keeps coming. just keeps coming in on Stanley Kubrick, mainly because of the opening up of his archive. So, and that will lead me into sort of what this project's about. Stanley Kubrick notoriously kept everything. And when he passed away in 1999, his family invited people to view the archives, and eventually they donated it to the University of the Arts in London, because they wanted it to stay close to the family home, which was just north of London in sort of Elstree Boreham Wood. And it's great that it's in London, because that means it's really accessible and I can go see my mum and stay with her. For those of you who know London, the downside, it's in Elephant and Castle. Not the nicest part of the world, but at least they've filled in that horrible, the underpasses between Elephant and Castle Station. So now it's much easier to get across the road. Anyway, I digress. So what this project has is sort of three things to underpinning it. And I'll put it quite simply: archives, ethnics, and ethics. So archives, ethnicity, and ethics. What I wanted to do with this was firstly exploit Stanley Kubrick's archive. As I said, there's this sort of voluminous and resource in London, and that really gives us an insight into not just how this person made his films, but also to the person himself. So that was point number one. Point number two, I wanted to consider Kubrick's ethnicity. He was born Jewish. He had two Jewish parents. He was raised in a, when I say a Jewish household, it's J-E-W, you know, dash-ish. He grew up in sort of middle-class Bronx, where even if you didn't keep anything or observe anything, you were Jewish, and everyone knew it because they were surrounded by so many other Jewish people, as well as other, you know, Italians as well, in that region. But he grew up in such a Jewish area that it didn't even need talking about. And I think that's important in the background, because people always ask, well, did he say he was Jewish? Did he talk about it? And I was like, well, he did, but he didn't need to. He never had a bar mitzvah because he wasn't interested. He wasn't really interested in learning, not in the kind of structured school sense of learning, but in terms of self-taught learning. So it's probably one of the reasons why he never had a bar mitzvah. I mean, did he have a kosher home? Probably almost likely, in the sense of every shop around him would have been a kosher shop. Whether it was deliberate or intentional is another issue entirely. But what I want to do is locate Kubrick in his ethnic milieu, and to consider him as a Jewish director, you know, whether or not he intentionally made Jewish films. I mean, one of my side issues is when I write about film, is there's only so many articles we can have on the jazz singer or on Woody Allen or Fiddler on the Roof, which celebrates 50 years this year, of course. You know, and it's obvious those are Jewish films. What we do, what I'm interested in, is exploring those films that can be read as Jewish, although it's not explicitly in your face, on the nose, Jewishness. And the third thing is this sense of ethics. For me, you know, if Kubrick is an intellectual, then what are his thoughts? What is he saying? What are his films trying to say? How is he responding to the key issues of his day and of his time? So one of the arguments I want to make is that Kubrick used his films to respond to the key issues of the day in the same way as an intellectual would use their chosen form of, say, writing, to convey their response to the key issues of the day. So, and there's the man himself. So as I go through this, I'll just...
Hey, Nathan, can you just alter the screen setting to get rid of the stuff at the top and things that fills the...
Yeah, how do I do that? All this?
I think it's the icon at the top row.
Right, screen sharing.
No, within your image. Just the top line, it's going...
You mean all this stuff? Is this the problem, yeah. David?
And the one about that.
Yeah, I don't know with Sway, because it's Sway.
All right. Okay, fine.
It's not PowerPoint.
Right, okay, fine.
If it's web based as opposed to... Do you want me to I'll close all these tabs if it bothers you. I presume it's these you're referring to.
Yeah. They don't, yeah.
There you go. That better?
Yeah.
If I close that, then you don't have a presentation.
Okay, fine.
Okay. Right, so just to give some context, I chose the title New York Jewish Intellectual deliberately because I wanted to refer to this group known as the New York Intellectuals. Now, who were they? So this is a group of largely, not exclusively, Jewish intelligentsia that sort of rose to prominence in the 30s, particularly the 40s, but particularly after World War II. And they wrote for such small publications as you can see here, Partisan Review, Commentary. If you look at the cover on the right, you can see some of the names of who those New York intellectuals would be. So Midge Dekter, Ruth Wiss there would be, she's sort of a younger one. Terry Teachout, a younger one. Lionel Trilling, one of the founder generation. And well, John Podhoretz is the son of Norman Podhoretz, who was editor of Commentary from 1960 onwards. So this was the group of intellectuals that included others, Saul Bellow, Norman Mailer, Dwight MacDonald, Irving Howe. I could reel off a whole list of names. Philip Ruff, if we look at this one here, who was the editor of this. Howard Rosenberg, the art critic. So it's this group of largely Jewish, Mary McCarthy, Diana Trilling, largely Jewish intellectuals that came to prominence, particularly in the post-war era, around magazines like Commentary, Partisan Review, Dissent, and then latterly they set up the New York Review of Books. And obviously there's the Woody Allen gag that would be remiss of me not to mention here, that he heard that Dissent and Commentary had merged to form Dysentery. And he's, when he makes that joke, he's obviously referring to these New York Jewish intellectuals. Now, I'm not suggesting that Kubrick was one of the New York Jewish intellectuals. He wasn't. But what I am suggesting is that he was very similar to them, both in age, location, and approach. Oh, so I'll go there. So hopefully you I'll read the quote out if it's too small on here. So in 1968, Irving Howe wrote an article that gave the kind of moniker New York intellectuals and thus sort of defined the contours and membership of the group. And he said, and I'm quoting here, they are until recently have been anti-communist. They are until some time ago were radicals. They have a fondness for ideological speculation. They write literary criticism with a strong social emphasis. They revel in polemic. They strive self-consciously to be brilliant. And by earth and by birth or osmosis, they are Jews. Now, just to go through those criteria, well, Kubrick, I wouldn't say he was anti-communist. I'm not really sure. We're not really sure what he was, but we can talk about that later on. It was sort of, again, politically radical, doubtful, radical in filmmaking terms, certainly. He did have a fondness for ideological speculation, which I think we can see in his movies. He didn't write literary criticism, but then not all the New York intellectuals did either. But he certainly he started off as a photographer and then became a filmmaker, and he certainly produced his work with a strong social emphasis. He certainly reveled in polemic, and he certainly strived self-consciously to be brilliant. And as I've explained at the outset, he was by birth and osmosis Jewish. The osmosis bit is for those who actually technically weren't Jewish, but they wanted to include in the group. Now, what the group I think Kubrick does belong to is what is known as the alternative New York intellectuals. And so this is a group of other Jewish people who I would consider intellectuals in the sense of they had the role and function of intellectuals, even if they didn't necessarily have the title of it. And here are some examples. I don't know if you recognize this chap who bears an uncanny resemblance. I can't see your reaction, so I can say what I want. If Prince Charles and George W. Bush had a child, they would have produced Alfred E. Newman. And Alfred E. Newman graced the cover of Mad Magazine. And Mad Magazine was certainly a group of alternative Jewish intellectuals who used the comic book format to produce strong social criticism and satire at a time when it wasn't so easy to do so during the McCarthy period, and was staffed largely by Jews and Jewish emigres who kind of skewered everything in their sight. And I'll come back to Mad Magazine. So that's one of these new, alternative sort of Jewish intellectuals that I think Kubrick bears comparison to and from whom he drew inspiration, like these other magazines as well. On the left, Bob Dylan. I hopefully don't need to explain much about Bob Dylan, but if you look at some of the lyrics of the songs that he's producing through the 60s, there's a lot of similarity and crossover with the themes articulated in Kubrick's films. Lenny Bruce there on the right, the great kind of comedian, and I can talk a bit more about him. On bottom left, Jules Pfeiffer, a graphic novelist, and here he is penning a book he published called 666 at the end of the 50s. And Joseph Heller, who's Catch 22, I'm sure you're all familiar with. My favorite thing to say about Catch 22 is that comment that when he was asked why he never wrote another book as good as Catch 22, he just replied, well, nor did anybody else. Of course, called Catch 22 because Miller 18 came out the same year, and he had to change it from Catch 18. Because, of course, Catch 18 just doesn't sound right, does it? But I've picked on these for a reason, at least three of them, because I think, because I know Kubrick wanted to work with them on his various movies. So he approached Lenny Bruce not Lenny Bruce. I'll talk about Lenny Bruce gets a sort of shout out one of the movies, but he approached Jules Pfeiffer and Joseph Heller and wanted to work with them on his movies. So basically, just to sum up what I'm saying is Kubrick parallels these kinds of groups of New York intellectuals, the official group, the alternative group. He never sort of had the title of it, although many people did refer to him as an intellectual and as Jewish and being from New York, they just hadn't put it all together. So for me, those are the sort of unique aspects of what I try to emphasize in my work in the book, that book I wrote a couple of years ago. So as I said, he started off as a photographer. I haven't included the photography here. I could do. But the interesting thing about the photography is there was sort of very little of his extant Jewishness in it, apart from a couple of photographs. One about a young Jewish boy emigrated to the United States who survived the Holocaust. But interestingly, in the picture he took of him, the one that got left out was the one that showed his number on his arm. But whether that was Kubrick's decision or someone else's, we don't know. So it kind of simultaneously alludes to the Holocaust, but doesn't, which is kind of a strategy for all of Kubrick's films. There was another one where there's a picture of a yeshiva bocher on a train reading his Yiddish newspaper out to a friend. And I imagine Kubrick included that photo because had things gone a bit differently, if the doors had slid another way, that might have been him in another life. But what I'm going to focus on is the films and explain how my approach to his films. So there's a kind of a dual approach, or dual, pun intended, approach to how I looked at Kubrick's movies. So number one, what I did was look at the movies and think, right, when did they come out? What's going on at the time? How do they relate to the issues of the day? How do they relate to the other kind of intellectual production of the time? What do we know Kubrick was reading and what can we presume he was reading and how might that have influenced from an intellectual Jewish perspective the way he made his films? So that was point number one. And that I very much root in historical kind of context, looking at his archives. The other one's a bit more playful, what I'd call the kind of midrashic approach, where it's an interpretive strategy. Where I say, right, I'm going to analyze his films from a Jewish perspective using the available evidence in front of me. I can't prove that he intended this. In fact, it doesn't even matter whether he intended it or not. It's just another way to read his movies. In the same way as not all Midrash is intended to be taken literally and doesn't need any recourse to the creator for its validation. In fact, as I often say to my students, I don't know if rabbis say the same thing, but I say to my students, authorial intention is one of a possible range of approaches and probably the least interesting. So if you're going to ask me, well, did he mean it, when I come up with a more playful kind of interpretation, well, that sort of misses the point. I will say where I thought he meant it. And if I come up with a playful strategy, I will. That's just me. It's a kind of hermeneutic approach, we'd call it, where in film studies, we just interpret the text. So it was similar in Judaism. The interesting thing, though, and primarily up until, you know, I'm not saying I'm the one solely responsible. There's been others whose work helped me. But primarily up until this point, when people had interpreted Kubrick, they'd done it primarily from a sort of Christological perspective. So they would interpret everything as being Christian. I thought, well, this is a bit absurd. This is a Jewish director. I mean, right, he might be an atheist or hedging his bets, I think, is probably better, rather than he might not have kept any Jewishness, and he loved Judaism and he loved Christmas. But at the same time, he didn't deny there was a God or a higher power. So I think, you know, why would a director make a Christian film? So I was trying to suggest, well, if you can impose your reading on it, here's a different alternative one, which actually I think bears closer relation to the author of these texts than the one that you're producing. So those are the kind of dual strategies I'm using. And hopefully that's clear. I can explain further if it isn't. So to go through his films, his first movie here on the right, on the left, sorry, is Fear and Desire. So this was a juvenile effort. He basically hired a camera, a skeleton crew, some actors, most of whom had never acted in a movie before, flew them out to California and made this kind of allegorical film, very much indebted to the sort of World War II platoon movie of different sort of ethnic racial groups in a platoon trapped behind enemy lines. So sort of standard staple of World War II. This was made during the Korean War, which started in 1950, and the movie was made in over 1950-51. It wasn't released till 53 for a variety of reasons. And it very much sort of commented on the Korean War in an allegorical form, also World War II, therefore has kind of subtextual references to the Holocaust. But the main interesting thing for me is one of the key characters in the movie is Paul Mazursky. And Paul Mazursky became a famous director in his own right. And this was his first film role, and he plays Private Sidney. And he's the kind of centerpiece of the film. And I think by having a Jewish actor playing this character that we can read as Jewish, I mean, take the name Sidney. Sidney's the sort of name that immigrant Jews gave their sons in the belief that it would help them blend into the sort of Anglo-Saxon culture of the United States, without realizing that the only people who gave their sons those names were Jews. And if you think of the numbers of Sidneys and Normans and Stanleys, Lionel, all this group of New York intellectuals, Norman Mailer, Norman Podhoretz, Lionel Trilling, Stanley Kramer, Sidney Lumet, Sidney Pollack, you know, I could go on. These are Jews giving their names, these sons. So there's the name. There's also, as I said, the actor, but there's also the way he plays it. I think it's a comment on kind of Jewish masculinity, particularly in the post-war era, and this sort of idea that you know, the weak diaspora Jew. And this was being played with in contemporary texts like Leonuris's, I forget the title, the one about the Marines based on his own experiences when he goes over to the Pacific Theater. I just have to remember Norman Mailer, The Naked and the Dead. So there's lots of sort of Jewish cultural production coming out at this time, also reflecting on that. Really, Fear and Desire is very much Kubrick's attempt to channel Conrad into a movie, and it bears a lot of similarity to Heart of Darkness in many ways. So what we can see in this early effort is an attempt to kind of respond to some of the issues of the day, to take on a sort of popular genre But to try and infuse it with some sort of heady ideas, in places it was criticized for being quite pretentious, and has been described as a kind of grab bag of bohemian Greenwich Village ideas where Kubrick was living at the time. He then moves on to make this movie, Killer's Kiss. This comes out in 1955. It's about a washed up boxer and his taxi dancing girlfriend. And here's a bit of nostalgia, actually. This picture has had a lot of, it's been reproduced recently because of the reconstruction of Penn Station. It was destroyed when they built Madison Square Garden. So there's sort of this nostalgia, this beautiful station that once was that they're now sort of resurrecting. But that's neither here nor there. But into creating a boxing movie, I don't know if any of you last night, there was a Jewish Historical Society of Leeds taught by Michael Berkowitz talking about Jews in boxing. And he referred to this cycle of boxing movies produced by and starring Jews that came out in the late 40s and early 50s, like Kirk Douglas in Champion, The Setup, there was the book The Ring, there was also Body and Soul. And then whilst it wasn't directed by someone Jewish, it was scripted by someone Jewish, Bud Schulberg's screenplay for On the Waterfront. So which all of these movies clearly influenced Killer's Kiss. So it's reflecting to kind of the genre, and but also contains some headier ideas referring to sort of existentialism that was becoming popular in the United States in the post-war era in the 40s and 50s, particularly amongst New York intellectuals, as well as Freudianism and psychoanalysis. So we can see those ideas in there in the movie as well. So it's trying to sort of produce something populist and commercial, but is reaching higher. And that's one of the characteristics of Kubrick's movies, is that he's very interesting as a filmmaker. If you compare him to some other purely intellectual ones, they're not looking at making a commercial return on their movies. Conversely, if you look at the populist directors, they're not interested in any big ideas. Michael Bay, who's Jewish, would be the probably contemporary equivalent of that. Kubrick straddled those two worlds of the art house medium, and he was heavily influenced by European techniques, by neorealism, by the Russian formalist Soviet montage, by experimental avant-garde filmmaking, but he wanted to make a commercial return on his movies. So these movies in particular straddle that boundary of being sort of art house pretentious on the one hand, but yet encased in popular genres. We see Soviet montage editing in this one. And here it's more about the kind of ideas, the existential ideas. Just another thing to think about, this Davy Gordon character can, you know, very much be read as the sort of washed out Jewish boxer. But not explicitly. In his third film, this is called The Killing, and very much is of a piece with the second film. They're both film noir. Again, film noir, heavily sort of Jewish genre, largely created by Jews fleeing, or those with Jewish heritage, fleeing Nazi Germany for the United States. In the 30s and 40s, and then using the techniques they'd learned in German expressionism and applying them to the new sort of American post-war genre that got dubbed film noir. And The Killing comes out the year after this, 56, and it's about a heist that goes wrong. And it's interesting because he cast a Jewish actor in the role of a loan shark, Jay Adler. Rodney Dangerfield has his first on-screen appearance, the Jewish comedian born Jacob Cohen. And if we look down in the movie, this is a still from the movie, we can see on the right here a poster advertising Lenny Bruce. And whether fortuitous or otherwise, he's kept it in the editing stage. Okay, I mean, remember, with filmmaking, by and large, everything you see is there for a reason. Because the director has total control over the environment. Now, if they've shot on location, guerrilla style, as Kubrick did, certainly for Killer's Kiss, and Fear and Desire, they at least have a choice of which shot to use when they come to editing. So they might have had a shot where that isn't in it, but he chose to keep this image in there. And there's a little nice little nod to Lenny Bruce, the comedian that I referred to earlier. Now, one of the strategies that Kubrick did, which I found particularly interesting, is that in his first two movies, these were original texts penned by his high school friend, Howard Sackler, who was writing for Commentary at the time by the late 40s and was published in Commentary magazine. So Kubrick would have been familiar with these magazines. Sackler went on to become an award-winning poet in his own right and worked on Jaws, probably the most famous movie. From this one onwards, he adapts source texts. So from his third film onwards, Kubrick always adapts from a pre-existing text. He never kind of invents ex nihilo from nothing. He always takes a source text. And what he does with a source text is very interesting. This is my argument, is he'll take a source text which has explicit references to Jews and Jewishness. He'll erase those, only then to reinsert a Jewish subtext into the film. That's my argument. Or at least he'll put things in the film that give us the ability to read it as Jewish. Okay, so that's part of the argument of this of the book, and in this one, some of the characters I mentioned, for example, the loan shark is explicitly Jewish. He's called a Shylock in the novel, which is Clean Break by Lionel White. Now those references are moved for the film, but a nod to that original text is kept by having a recognizably sort of Jewish actor, Yiddish actor, play the role of the loan shark. So I find that an interesting strategy, but it's the way this argument works is you're only able to make the reading if you have the knowledge. And it doesn't matter if you don't, because it doesn't change your enjoyment of the film. But if you do have the knowledge, then it gives you an extra reading that's denied to those who don't have the knowledge. So that's part of the argument I'm making there. Very interesting, nice sort of lighting here. It's a film noir lighting using an existing light source in the screen, in the shot, that's known as a practical. Anyway, so these kind of three black and white efforts are very much kind of existential, intellectual, bohemian, Freudian, but fit into popular genres. So the war movie and sexploitation, as you can see from the poster, very much, I mean, the Virginia Leaf here, the model who played, has a tiny role in the movie, but the entire like advertising in the movie surrounds her and her image. And then it's paired up with this movie about a French prostitute, the male brute, as a double bill. So you can see, although he's reaching for something higher, it gets bracketed as kind of art house sexploitation. Interestingly, the distributor of this film was Joseph Burstyn, who's always a Polish Jew, who was responsible for importing neorealism into the United States, Italian neorealism. And then these movies are film noir and boxing and the heist. But again, reaching for something higher with this sort of Jewish subtext running through it. For those of you who are just into film generally, I mean, this probably had an influence on Raging Bull, as did On the Waterfront. And this certainly influenced Tarantino with Reservoir Dogs and Pulp Fiction, with it's a non-linear narrated story where the heist takes place, but with flashbacks and whatnot, so that the story doesn't just sort of proceed in a simple fashion. Anyway, that got him attention in 1956. He was invited to MGM in 1956. And in the introduction, you have referred to my appearance on Radio 4, and that was to discuss Burning Secret, which was a Stefan Zweig novella that he wanted to adapt in 56 under contract to MGM. And of course, Stefan Zweig, Viennese writer, contemporary with Arthur Schnitzler. I won't have time to cover all of this, but Kubrick was fascinated with Viennese literature, with that whole culture, and spent his career attempting to adapt, Arthur Schnitzler, but also Stefan Zweig's work. And The Burning Secret's interesting because, for those of you unfamiliar with it, the tale is of a Jewish class woman holidaying at a spa town with her son, and a bored Baron attempts to seduce her by using the sun as a go-between, and eventually the sun witnesses them kissing and he runs away to go tell his father this burning secret. And obviously the movie's about whether he did or didn't. And the reason why it made news a few years ago is because we thought the script had been lost, and Gerald Fried, who composed the music for these movies, Fear and Desire Through to Paths of Glory, turns out he had one in his closet the whole time for 50 years and no one had seen it since. So that's very interesting. But in typical style, like I alluded to, Kubrick removes the explicit Jewishness of the source text in his adaptation by translating it into an American idiom. But at the same time, for those familiar with the text, you can't erase it. It would be trying to make Fiddler on the Roof as a violinist on the balcony, and let's make Tevye Thomas. You know, it just isn't going to work. You can't whitewash it. Anyway, that project falls through, and Burning Secret, mainly because there were internal power struggles at MGM because it was losing money. But at the same time, it turns out Kubrick was simultaneously, against the terms of his contract, working on adapting this novel, Paths of Glory, which is a First World War film. It was based on a novel by Humphrey Cobb that came out in 1935. It was also a play based on a true story in the French military during World War I, where soldiers were told to take an impossible position, and of course they failed, and then the top brass, rather than take responsibility, wanted to scapegoat the unit and executed the I can't remember the original. In the film it's three. They selected three soldiers for execution, and it's this great miscarriage and injustice. Now I think it's very interesting that Kubrick chose this. I mean, firstly, referring to what I said earlier, the novel has an explicit Jewish character in it, and his commanding officer says, "We can't pick him." They said, "Why can't we pick him? He's socially undesirable." Yes, that might be true, but he's Jewish, and we can't have another Dreyfus affair on our hands. So the novel's very explicit about this. And bear in mind, the French military code that was in practice between 1940 and 1919 was the same military code that convicted Dreyfus. So underpinning any kind of French text, I think, certainly up to including 1945, is Dreyfus and the anti-Semitism of France. But Kubrick erases this for the film. He keeps in the Jewish character, but never refers to him by name. Well, he does refer to him by name, but we never see him on screen. So it's a very interesting strategy here of kind of simultaneously alluding but not alluding to the Jewishness of the source text. But I think one of the reasons that led him to this is it's the war genre. It's about military hierarchies. It's about a miscarriage of justice. It's got all the elements of a great story. But similarly, I think it's one of his ways of tackling the Holocaust and anti-Semitism, although somewhat obliquely. I think it was Hannah Arendt who described Dreyfus as a kind of rehearsal for the Holocaust. But the most interesting point in the movie is the casting of this chap. You'll get to see a movie in a bit, sorry. It's more of a talky talk than a showy film clips talk. He brings Kirk Douglas on board. Well, in fact, if anything, Kirk Douglas signs Kubrick up. He signs it up to his production company called Briner. It's named after his mother. And for one third of the total budget, he agrees to be the leading man. And I think in so doing, it lends itself much more of a subsurface sort of Jewish quality, because by having this recognizably Jewish star, Issa Danilovich, on screen, topless in the first shot that we see him, sets up this idea of what I call in the book the macho mensch. So he's a mensch, he's a fine upstanding human being in every respect, but he's also tough and strong and a good soldier. So we get the blending of kind of two stereotypes, you know, the macho Jew, which is very much more kind of applied to Israelis, coupled with the sort of the more, not to suggest Israelis aren't on a dodgy territory, but you know, the more thoughtful, intellectual, moral stereotype from the diaspora. And we see that kind of in the body of Kirk Douglas, and especially when he's topless in his first shot. But again, contracts dictate that the star has to be shown topless at least once in the movie. So no doubt that was Kirk Douglas's personality all over that one. Anyway, I'll move on to one. We'll get to a clip in a minute. Then the next film he makes after a few years in the wilderness is, so Kubrick goes to Germany, interestingly, to make Paths of Glory. And that includes a visit to Dachau. Although what he felt about it, we don't know, because he was filming near Dachau. So this is 1957. He's actually working with crew who were part of the Nazi sort of filmmaking machine. Again, we don't know how he felt about that, or they about him. His first two wives up until this point are Jewish. So on this movie, he works with Toba Metz, his Jewish high school sweetheart, and she appears briefly in the film. And then he leaves her whilst making this film for a Viennese emigre called Ruth Sobotka, whose father was a famous architect, and she was a ballet dancer in her own right, had her own career. And she helped on this movie and appeared in it. And she also helped on this movie. But whilst working on this, him and Toba Metz split up. He then was with Ruth Sobotka. But then whilst making this movie, they split up. He runs away to Germany, and he meets Christiane Harlan, who is the niece of Veet Harlan, who's responsible for such anti-Semitic classics as Jude Sus. So Kubrick not only marries out to a German woman, but the niece of a very famous Nazi, well, and unrepentant Nazi filmmaker. And that fascinated Kubrick for the rest of his life. So there's a lot of psychoanalytic territory we could go into here about Kubrick and marrying not just a German woman, but a non-Jewish German woman, whose uncle was a famous Nazi filmmaker. I haven't got time to go into that here, but there is something to think about the subsequent influence on his career. One of the things I'm trying to work on is to remove this idea of Kubrick as a lone genius, and actually to emphasize the collaboration and the collaborative aspects of his filmmaking, and the fact that without that collaboration, he would certainly not have been the genius that he's been hailed to be. And a key part of that collaboration is the role that his wives played, and they've really been relegated in the scholarship. So one of the attempts of this biography I'm working on and a piece I've got coming out in an academic journal is to try and rescue the Jewish women that made him who he was. I'm focusing on the Jewish women, obviously, because I focus on the Jewish aspects, but also other women too. Anyway, the film that really makes his name in 1960 is Spartacus. This is another Briner production that Kirk Douglas is producer and star. And Kirk Douglas fires his director, Anthony Mann. There's some dispute over the date, but about 3 weeks into production. And he remembers the good work that Kubrick did on Paths of Glory and asks him to come in to Spartacus at a very late stage. I mean, they were in the middle of production now, so it had no influence over any of the casting or pre-production. And he probably thought, you know what, I can control this young kid, because Kubrick's not yet 32 by this point. He's born in 28, I should have mentioned. So he's 31 by this point. So he probably thinks, I can control this kid. For Kubrick's part, he needed the money. He had a family now. And Christiane had a daughter, and shortly after they met, they had a second daughter. So he had a family to feed, and it was just his chance to helm a big budget Hollywood production with a very extremely well-known cast. As you can see down there, you know, the cream of British talent. Certainly the interesting thing about this is that I'm just thinking who they've met though, and Tony Curtis, I can get to him. So the interesting thing about, I mean, I could talk so much about the influence of Spartacus on Kubrick's career as a filmmaker. Again, that's another talk. It's been a massively overlooked movie because people don't think it's a Kubrick film. It had its 60th anniversary in December, and there's a piece on Do You Think About It, just summarizing the Jewishness of the movie. But it's based on this Howard Fast novel, an extremely best-selling novel by Howard Fast, who was a Jewish communist who went to prison. And in Spartacus, the novel, at least one of the chapters is narrated by this character called David the Jew. So the novel's explicitly Jewish. And when it's adapted for film, there's all these Jewish sort of input into it. There's Howard Fast, there's Stanley Kubrick, there's Kirk Douglas, there's Tony Curtis is brought on board. Tony Curtis is brought on board because as a favor. So Tony Curtis killed Kirk Douglas in Vikings. So in return, Kirk Douglas gets to kill Tony Curtis in Spartacus. Sorry, spoiler alert. And as the Jewish Chronicle announced in 1959, even the Vikings are Jewish. So there's this sort of subtextual Jewishness to the movie by the very casting and the kind of creative voices around it. Interestingly, Dalton Trumbo, who is a blacklisted Hollywood writer, was brought on board to beef up Howard Fast's original script. And Dalton Trumbo had to write under the pseudonym Sam Jackson because he was blacklisted. And had he had his way, he would have made the script even more Jewish than the Jewish people who worked on it, with all this anachronistic references to the Talmud and the Talit and even the production code administration when they looked at it and went, no, this stuff's got to go. So it's interesting, the least Jewish person on the movie wanted to make the most Jewish of movies, and all the Jews said no, and they were right. At one point, Dalton Trumbo wanted a mass wedding. And Kubrick said no, because it reminds me too much of the marriage of Hitler and Eva Braun. So just an interesting little allusion to the Holocaust and Jewishness in that response there. So there's loads of sort of subsurface Jewishness underpinning the film, again with Kirk Douglas writ large. Now this character of David the Jew fits this strategy that I outlined perfectly. David the Jew is cast in the film, is played by Harold J. Stone, who's a recognisably Jewish actor. But all the extant Jewishness of the character is drained out and absorbed by the character Spartacus, as played by Kirk Douglas. And Harold J. Stone remains on screen. Okay, so people who know him will go, oh, that's Harold J. Stone, I know he's Jewish. But his name's never mentioned, right? We just know he's David, but I don't think he's ever said David the Jew. So it's that simultaneous strategy of removing the extant Jewishness yet keeping it in. It's part of the contradiction of Kubrick's personality. Anyway, just even an example of how we read the film. I'll just show you one. I mean, there's loads of examples. Spartacus really very much fit in to the key concerns of the period. If you think, came out in 1960, Dalton Trumbo also wrote Exodus that came out the same year. So it deals with all that. It very much deals with the exodus from Egypt in the way that the film looks. It deals with McCarthyism and the House Un-American Activities Committee's investigations into Hollywood. It deals with civil rights. So it's got all the kind of intellectual elements in the film that intellectuals are discussing in 1960, as does Paths of Glory in 1957. But let's just watch one sequence just to give you a break from my voice for a second.
Have we a count of prisoners?
We haven't made the final count, sir.
I bring a message from your master, Marcus Licinius Crassus, commander of Italy. By command of his most merciful excellency, your lives are to be spared. Slaves you were, and slaves you remain. But the terrible penalty of crucifixion has been set aside on the single condition that you identify the body or the living person of the slave called Spartacus.
I'm Spartacus!
I'm Spartacus.
Okay. Oh, that let's run out then.
I'm Spartacus! I'm Spartacus! I'm Spartacus!
I'm Spartacus!
I'm Spartacus!
I'm Spartacus! I'm Spartacus!
I'm Spartacus!
I'm Spartacus!
Spartacus!
I'm Spartacus!
Right. A much mimic sequence, so if you didn't know that one. This one has been sort of read as an allusion to the refusal to name names before the House Un-American Activities Committee, like a direct attack on that. There's some dispute about whether Kubrick actually wanted to include this scene or not, but it's in the finished movie, even if he didn't edit it. But he restored it in the 91 version, which was much closer to his vision than what came out in 1960. But to go back to what, just to illustrate what I was saying earlier, so here's the three characters. This is Antoninus, played by Tony Curtis, with a recognisably Bronx accent that critics pointed out, that we now can see that the Tiber is a tributary of the Bronx River. Douglas, I've mentioned, and, you know, Mada Fada. And then this is Harold J. Stone as David the Jew. So we recognise the actor, we just sort of wouldn't necessarily know who he was without, but those familiar with the novel would. If we go back, the reason why I started here, just to play you it again, is in 1960, I think it's very hard not to look at scenes like this and connect them to the sort of documentary footage that had come out of the camps, especially that background shot there. In the background, and you know, all right, those are map paintings, but these are all actual people. You know, they use thousands of extras for this. And this is the aftermath of a battle sequence where the Romans indiscriminately slaughter men, women, and children. And Laurence Olivier here calmly strides the battlefield as if he's sort of some kind of Nazi officer, as been pointed out. Interestingly, this is all shot in Franco Spain. And the battle sequences, an interesting contradiction there is that Jewish directors, amongst others, were wooed to make their films in Spain as part of an effort to cover up the crimes of Franco. Although, you know, Franco was neutral during World War II, there were still lots of atrocities committed in Spain, and yet these directors had no problem making their movies there. So there are some questionable ethics behind these movies. That's a sort of tangential issue there. But I think that shot was kept in as a sort of direct reference to the Holocaust, which happened only 15 years earlier. Another interesting point is that Pauline Kael, the very famously sharp-tongued Jewish critic who hated Kubrick's work by and large, did refer to this slave army as one giant kibbutz on the move, which I found rather interesting. Anyway, Kubrick wraps on Spartacus and goes back to the novel he really wants to make, which is Lolita in 1962. And this is very interesting because for Lolita, this is based on the Nabokov, 55 in French, and then it came out in 58 in English, novel of the same name. And there's a lot of interesting research about Nabokov. He wasn't Jewish, but his wife and son were, and his wife Vera played a huge part in his career, not least rescuing Lolita from the bin when Nabokov wanted to trash it. And there's probably some research to be done on how much more influence she had on the text itself. But certainly, as scholars have pointed out, there's lots of Jewish references, both explicit and implicit, underpinning the source text. You know, whether that's one of the things that appealed to Kubrick, we'll never know, but it was there. And for the lead role of Charlotte Hayes, so obviously he'd moved to England by this point to make the movie. And for the lead role of Charlotte Hayes, he cast Shelley Winters. And I think it's a very interesting piece of casting. You know, Shelley Winters hadn't played any Jewish roles up to that point. She specialised in being the blonde who was killed halfway through a movie, like Night of the Hunter, amongst others. But from Lolita onwards got stereotyped and typecast as the Jewish mother, and not least in a Paul Mazursky film about his experiences in the village at the time he knew Kubrick, and being cast in for a desire called Next Stop Greenwich Village. But interestingly, in 1959, she won Best Supporting Actress for playing Mrs. Van Dan in The Diary of Anne Frank. So part of the thing that we argue in film studies is that actors bring their past roles with them. And that's part of the kind of interpretation that we make of a film. You know, if you think of Arnold Schwarzenegger in any movie, you're not there thinking this is going to be a Shakespearean drama. And if it is, you know, there's something amiss. But so similarly, in a less sort of telegraphed way, with the casting of Shelley Winters, we have the baggage of Mrs. Van Dan. Baggage probably isn't the right term, but at least the ideological attachments of Mrs. Van Dan are brought to the movie, and help us read the character. And it's possibly one of the reasons why she was typecast as a Jewish mother of the sins. Now, I'm not saying the character is explicitly Jewish, she isn't, but we read her. It's part of this interpretive strategy I was referring to, whether we can read her as Jewish. And she very much fits into the stereotype of Jewish American women that was coming out of literature, like Herman Wouk's Marjorie Morningstar in the 50s, and then sort of most prominently in Philip Roth in the 60s. So, you know, I think Portnoy's Complaint. So, like I said, when we compare to what other Jewish intellectuals are writing about, there's a lot of overlap and similarity. I'll come to these other two texts in a minute. I'll just play this really brief clip.
Sieg Heil.
Okay.
Sieg Heil.
Oh. So a little explicit reference to World War II and Nazism in Lolita, when Lolita gives albeit left arm salute to her mother, after a mother tells her she's about to send her away to a camp for isolation. It's sort of euphemistic. In this case, it is actually a summer camp. But this euphemistic language, which becomes much more evident in Kubrick's next film, very much tallies in with a book that was published just the year before, 61. This film was made, which is 62. And this is Raoul Hilberg's The Destruction of the European Jews, which we know Kubrick read, although if he read it in 61, I'm not 100% sure, but we certainly know he read it later. But a lot of the use of euphemism, both in this movie and his next movie, very much related to texts that were being discussed at the time. Betty Friedan publishes The Feminine Mystique, where she refers to the condition of the suburban housewife as being that of a comfortable concentration camp. And so what we have in the early 60s, and Friedan wasn't the only one, we have Jewish intellectuals using Holocaust metaphors in understanding whatever situation they were looking at. So Betty Friedan obviously is a progenitor of that wave of feminism. Stanley Elkins is talking about slavery as a concentration camp. Robert J. Lifton is looking at Hiroshima's survivors in the sense of Holocaust survivors. And most prominently, I'll just see if we come to the text here, Stanley Milgram at that point, see all these names, Stanley, is doing his experiments that get published as Obedience to Authority a bit later, actually, 70. I'll just finish with this example. I realize I've probably talked for like far too long. But let me just explain this one example, and then I can't go through all his films in this level of detail. Sorry. His next film, 1964, Dr. Strangelove, connects nuclear Holocaust with the Holocaust, with a capital H, particularly through this figure of Dr. Strangelove, played by Peter Sellers. Peter Sellers plays a key role in Lolita, as he does in Dr. Strangelove. And it's another way we can read the Jewishness into the film. I haven't got time, I can answer that in questions, but there's loads of possibilities with both the casting and the way that Sellers plays his role, in both films. Anyway, Dr. Strangelove, the text underpinning this, as I said, I've referred to The Destruction of European Jews. This is popularized as the series of articles that Hannah Arendt based on the trial of Eichmann, in the early 60s, which is, gets compiled as Eichmann in Jerusalem. And basically Hannah Arendt, I'm not saying she stole his ideas, but certainly popularized ideas of this tome, this massive tome, where she basically made two points, and I think they're relevant to the film. One, Jews cooperated in their own destruction. Hannah Arendt has argued that without Jewish cooperation, the Nazi killing wouldn't have been nearly as effective. Again, highly controversial. It's not, the important thing is not whether she was right or wrong about Eichmann, is the impact of her ideas. And secondly, she characterized Eichmann's evil as banal. I won't go into too much more detail, but it's this phrase, the banality of evil and unthinkingness, that I think is important here. So when Kubrick makes Dr. Strangelove, there's two sequences I want to show you. Firstly, he kind of parodies sort of Nazis through this figure of Dr. Strangelove, the title figure, played by Peter Sellers, very much in a vaudevillian way. Although interestingly, out of about the seven different persona that this character is based on, Werner von Braun being the most obvious one, obviously the Nazi rocket scientist who led NASA space program, who had times been different, would have been convicted of war crimes. The other six people on whom he was based, including Kubrick himself, were all Jewish. And when Midge Dechter in commentary did a review of the film, she said, why didn't she make him Jewish? Maybe that was a step too far for Kubrick, but we can think about that. But let's just watch this anyway. I mean, I love...
Why should you build such a thing?
There are those of us who fought against
this. This is my favorite Kubrick movie, so it's always,
But in the end, we could not keep up with the expense involved in the arms race, the space race, and the peace race. And at the same time, our people grumbled for more nylons and washing machines. Our doomsday scheme cost us just a small fraction of what we've been spending on defense in a single year. But the deciding factor...
I commissioned last year a study of this project by the Bland Corporation. Based on the findings of the report, my conclusion was that this idea was not a practical deterrent for reasons which at this moment must be all too obvious.
Then you mean it is possible for them to have built such a thing?
Mr. President, the technology required is easily within the means of even the smallest nuclear power. It requires only the will to do so.
Okay, so here we have this sort of Nazi caricature, but the having the Nazi at the heart of this fantastic war room. You probably heard the anecdote that when Ronald Reagan was elected, when he became president in 81, he was asked to be taken to the war room, thinking that that set was actually real. And the set was designed by Ken Adam, the only German-born Jew to serve in the RAF, who was hired on the basis of the work he had done for Dr. No in 1962, which has a Jew playing its protagonist in Dr. No, and of course James Bond's Jewish, but that's another talk. And so we've got this sort of Holocaust, sort of World War II subtext to the entire movie, with this Dr. Strangelove at the heart of this genocidal project. Because what is nuclear warfare or nuclear Holocaust other than genocide on a mass scale? And I want to show you this sequence, and then I'll explain these cards, and then we can move to questions. I know I've gone on a bit, sorry. This is also Peter Sellers here. He plays the president. He plays three roles in the movie. And there's a great sequence, I don't have it here, where he's improvising on set, and this character can be seen trying not to laugh like a guilty schoolboy. But I just want to show you this bit. This is Darth Vader's first film role, at least the voice of Darth Vader, James Earl Jones. I'll just mute it, just to give a bit of context. So the radio of this bomber has been disabled, and it's a B-52 bomber carrying its nuclear payload to Russia. And it's going to drop its payload, but unbeknownst to the crew, in doing so, it will set off a chain reaction that will destroy all human life on the Earth. But they're not thinking of the consequences of their action. They're only thinking about delivering their payment.
Yes, lights on.
So I just want to, you know.
Second safety release.
Second safety.
Check bomb door circuits 1 through 4.
Bomb door circuits, negative function. Lights red.
Switching backup circuits.
Roger. Backup circuits switched in, still negative function.
Engage emergency power.
Roger. Emergency power on, still negative function.
Operate manual override.
Roger. Still negative function. The Teleflex drive cable must be sheared away.
Fire the explosive bolt.
Roger. Still negative, sir. The operating circuits are dead, sir.
Stay on the bomb run, Ace. I'm going down below and see what I can do.
Roger.
Right, I won't give any spoilers. I'll just go through these last few images and then explain, try and wrap it all up. So what we have here is the bomb crew on the mission, and they're trying to obviously release their nuclear payload, but they can't because the bomb doors have been disabled. But they're going through every tiny little bit of the procedure as one tiny little cog in the machine, carrying out their task, which will lead to this mass genocide. But they're not thinking about the wider implications of it. They're just doing the tiny little bit that's been assigned to them. And this is kind of a classic example of what Arendt referred to as the banality of evil, and the unthinkingness shown by Eichmann as part of his role in the wider kind of destruction of the Holocaust. And interestingly, when Stanley Milgram, whose experiments were being conducted to try and understand the Nazi mentality and how they could kill in such a way on such a mass scale, he cited in his book this very sequence, when he came to publish it, this very sequence of the movie as being an example of what he was talking about. Interestingly, he opened the book with Genesis 22, you know, the Akedah, the binding of Isaac, as being the classic problem of the obedience to authority. We'll talk more about that. Just keep me going for ages. So what we have here underpinning Dr. Strangelove is probably the film that up to that point most explicitly brings in the kind of intellectual text. And it's a huge cause célèbre of the early 60s amongst intellectuals. People fell out over this. That refers to these kinds of books and this fits into this kind of context. But if you need any more explicit evidence that Kubrick was referring to those, I actually in this case have found it. So these two cards in the middle are two kind of, you know, I call them recipe cards. I don't know what the technical name is. You know, my mum had all her recipes on these cards back in the day, not these ones, obviously. And these, he had a whole set of them in his pre-production notes. And if you can't read his writing, I'll read it for you. 6 million Jews cooperated in their destruction. So you can see very clearly repeating the ideas of Hilberg and Arendt. 400 to 600 million USA, Europe, Russia, all do the same thing. Okay, so very explicitly sort of bringing on board the ideas that he had read in those books. And if he hadn't read them, he still reflects those books. And then Walt Disney's shot of lemmings jumping off cliff by tens of thousands, 6 million due to the gas. So he's very much taken on board that idea of both the banality of evil and Jews cooperating in their own destruction. And one of the ways we know this is in the original book that this was based on, the radio navigator was Jewish. and he kept that navigator as Jewish, and played by a Jewish actor, and he's called Goldberg, so he's got a recognizably Jewish name, and he's eating. Of course, that makes him Jewish. And just one final thing is one of the just to connect it is one of the aircraft crew is reading Playboy magazine, and across the models behind is you can't make it out, but it says Foreign Affairs. So little sort of joke there at the at a security journal, but play on the words of Foreign Affairs, because she's having an affair with at least one Air Force general. But in the original notes, this was meant to be Commentary magazine. So a little nod back to those intellectual journals that I mentioned at the outset. I've gone on, hopefully not rambled, for ages. So, and I've still probably got six films to go. So maybe I should leave it there. You can do the second half when I can come visit you in person. 2001 onwards, I think 2001, Clockwork Orange, Barry Lyndon. I've still got six, seven films to go. So would this be a good place to take questions?
Yeah, thanks.